folks who say that I'm a dreamer, and I've no doubt there's truth in what they say. But sure a body's bound to be a dreamer when all the things he loves are far away.
Okay, so it, like 25 acres.
Our dreams onto an exile. They'll take more the land across the sea. Especially when it happens here.
That's the land right round, the green field right round is the boundary.
On where that hedge is?
On round where the yellow whins are.
Oh, okay.
And the same up, right round that green field.
Mm-hmm.
And then it goes right up to the top of the laneway up the top.
What?
Sheila and myself lived over there when we got married first, in that house. Lawrence owned it at the time, he sold it since.
And they would have grown potatoes and corn here?
Yeah, plenty enough little field there. And you see, they've taken out the ditches. There used to be, all the fields were that size.
Okay, so...
In a video now, you have to talk.
I have to talk?
Yes, tell me, what? Tell me about these little doors here.
Well, I was born in 1938, on the 30th of July, 1938, in this homestead here. And my first memories of when I was 4 or 5 years of old, 4 or 5 years of age, would have been my father and the mother, Lord of Mercy. There would have been some cows, and there was always a couple of horses.
In this area here.
And this, okay. Is, this shed here, this is where the horses were kept, and in the other, where the larger doors, that's where the cows were.
Oh, so in the house?
In the house. They were brought in there during the winter weather and housed there.
Was there a wall between where they were?
Oh, yeah, there was a wall. Yeah, there was a wall between the two of them.
Oh, I see.
And the rest of the fields down here were, there was ditches and hedges in them, but those were taken out in much later years.
Mm-hmm.
And there was another farm of land here in front of us, just those fields there, and that was known as Dewey Murphy. And Dewey Murphy was a horse dealer.
Now show me again.
This is the well. It's a bit grown over, but that's where they got the water from.
Wow.
And we're getting to take a bath in the well as well, you see.
They would take a bath in there?
In here, this was there, but it was, Mummy used to churn.
Oh, no.
Do the churning.
With the butter?
The butter.
Oh.
To make the butter. But then before Mummy died, or a good while before she died, she done it up for a wee, as a kitchen, you know?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And is this the room where this they would have gathered mostly?
Well, this was kind of the dining room or the upper room we own, it's called, you know.
No.
And there was an upstairs then at that time, too?
Oh, yeah, upstairs. You see, this part of the house, then, this is the part of the house that was thatched. Oh, no, really only from the kitchen down. This was all that went in. And this would be...
That's the granny and granddad's wedding picture?
Yeah.
They're not as friendly.
That's Mummy and Daddy's wedding picture there.
Wow. There. Colette, go ahead.
Small stairs. This was a bedroom, but Jennifer has it done.
So all of the kids would stay in this room, so
yeah.
There'd be like seven kids in this one room?
Yeah.
What do you think, girls?
And they all want rooms of their own now.
They have rooms of their own. This was into the barn?
Into the barn. And they made another bedroom. Mommy and Daddy made another bedroom and the bathroom. There was no bathroom, not as an office.
Oh, yeah.
But this is the bedroom Mommy and Daddy used to, this was their bedroom.
Hmm.
And I'm sure maybe...
What's that on the wall? That's interesting.
Jennifer and them had that, or Aidan
had that. Aidan had that, a lady in Chicago gave him that.
This was into the barn?
Into the barn. And they made another bedroom. Mummy and Daddy made another bedroom and the bathroom. There was no bathroom. Or there was no, at that time there was no water or no inside toilets or anything.
Oh, so this was a barn?
This was part of the barn.
Oh,
yeah.
Wow.
Father saying that in around the 1920s, my father, who, Lord of Mercy, was born in 1911, and the Tans raided this house on many, many occasions.
The Tans being?
Black and Tans. The Black and Tans were the British Electorate Police. They were looking for the IRA members, and many occasions, when they did come here, this portion here was thatched. They would go up into the bedrooms and see was the bedrooms warm, and on a few occasions they did. They did actually were very near catching some of the lads that were on the run. These are lads that were in the IRA. A number of people stayed here. One of them, the most famous, I suppose, Irishman for a long time, would have been Ono Duffy.
Mm-hmm.
Ono Duffy was the first commissioner of the Gardaí. He stayed here with a man by the name of Dan Hogan, whose brother was shot at Croke Park in 1920. And another gentleman from Carrickmacross, Dan Hogan. And it was partly from here that the 5th Northern Division of the IRA was run.
Hmm.
The reason for that was, there was a reason for that is because of the location of the house. There's a road runs over there, quite a distance, about 2 miles there. And there's another road runs parallel there. So in order to get them here, they would have to come across the fields from either side. The location was ideal. And there would be people on the guard in those areas to let them know the Tans were coming.
Oh, I see.
And this is why the location was, so they usually could get. There were never any of them caught here. But I remember my father telling me that they would be in bad humour and very upset. And on a couple of occasions, they fired shots out through the roof.
Who did?
The Black and Tan.
Oh.
In revenge.
Oh, because they couldn't catch them.
Couldn't catch them.
But there was a division of the IRA that was run out of this house?
Yeah, the 5th Northern Division was run out of here.
Oh. Well, that's news to me.
And after the Civil War, and in this area, in that bogland over there, that's where the arms were buried. And they're still there to the present day. They're probably rusted away.
After the first Civil War, the arms were buried there?
In the 1920s, they were buried. In fact...
Do people know that? Is that widely known?
Well,
or?
The family would know it. In fact, in this hedge here, my brother Owen and my brother Noel found my uncle Jimmy's revolver.
Ah.
In fact, Uncle only has it at home.
That's fascinating.
So, sadly to say that things didn't change much, and in the 70s and 80s this house was still being raided.
Really?
Still being searched. It was searched on many occasions.
And was it...
There was never anything found here.
So this is the road. That was the driveway we just came.
That's the driveway you came up.
This is the road.
And this is what they call the town path. On the town lane. Into Notting Hill.
That's not the road, or is it...
It's the crossroads here. I see.
I see.
So this is the way she went to school.
And how would they get to school?
Walk. Well, it wasn't very far, really. We wouldn't have been that way. I walked to school, too, the same way.
Mm-hmm.
Out here and turned right. Now we're going to go down. I'm going to bring you down to the school and show you the school.
Okay.
The school has closed a couple of years. It's not in use anymore, but it's still here. I'll bring you down there. It's just down the way.
There's a mark on it, is it?
Where would the mark?
You see that?
What ages would the children in this school be? Oh, I see.
Well, they went there about 14 years of age. Sorry.
Oh, yeah, no, it's okay.
Morning. Right, yes. Well, stand. Out the 20 minutes old. New calf.
It was born as we arrived. Just right on cue.
This
is Monaghan Town, sort of a town square on a Sunday morning. This is the Nakatalan Church, where Granny would have gone to church on Sundays. There's a calf. And that is the store where Granny worked. The building where the store was, anyway. Right in the center of Monaghan. So this is the railway station where they would have gotten on the train to get on the boat.
Yes.
To go to America from where in Ireland? Down near Cork? What's it called? Cove? Cove?
Or it could have been Derry.
I can't even read.
Are you looking at?
I'm looking for
John.
No, I'm looking for Sherman-McKenna, not in alone.
Right there.
Oh, 1931, yeah.
1931. She died sudden.
She was only 24.
24th of June, she was 57.
Oh, she died 24. Is, sorry, 57, yeah, she's sad.
She died fairly young.
And so that's why she was buried here in the McNaughton plot?
Well, the reason that she wasn't buried in the McKenna plot, which is across the far side, was that there was a large family of the McKennas. And if you look down the list that I wrote out, or you wrote out, and down in that list, it'll probably make sense to you. So, she was buried with her father and mother in the McNaughton plot. Okay? My grandfather, John McKenna, he died the year after I was born, John McKenna. Her husband.
Oh, yes, yes, yes.
That is your grandfather, or your mother's father.
My grandmother's father, great-grandfather.
Yeah, your great-grandfather was John McKenna. He died in 1939, and in fact, he returned from America 6 months, or a very short period before he died. He had went out to the United States because my Uncle Jimmy was lost and couldn't be found. And he thought he'd be of some help or some support to his family. They weren't successful and the war broke out and he got the last passenger vessel back to Ireland. And he was home a very short time and he died. So he was buried with his wife.
So he was a widower for a long time?
Yes. Yes, that's true indeed.
Ned McKenna was born in
Monaghan.
Oh, he was born in Monaghan.
We think that. We'll have to check it out, but we think he was born in Monaghan. And we think he came to Monaghan alone. There's two of his sons buried there. Two of Ned McKenna's sons. Ned McKenna was married to Susan Fair Sherry. Two of his sons are buried there. Owen McKenna was buried there. And James McKenna was buried there. And his other son is buried in the other side in the McNaughton plant. In the McNaughton plot. That was the three boys. There was no girls in it.
And about what year would Ned McKenna have been born?
We don't know. We're going to try and look that back. That's we don't really know. He had three sons.
This is a memorial to Seamus McElwain from Dogstown, killed in 1986 at 26 years old. It says, as long as Ireland is unfree, the only honorable attitude for Irishmen and Irishwomen is an attitude of revolt. I have turned my face to this road before me, to the deeds that I see and the death I shall die. P.H. Kirk. So the British would wear uniforms,
right? Oh, yeah, the
British.
Right? A lot of officers have uniforms on them, too, but they'd be hiding, you see.
Mm-hmm.
Then the British got fat and they couldn't come out at all to the border. It was too dangerous. There's a little river here, you see.
And does this bridge have a name?
This is Derivullen.
I'll turn and let you take a photograph when you're coming back down.
And
this is the border, basically?
Yeah, you're in County Fermanagh now. You're in Northern Ireland.
Oh, we just crossed the border.
We just crossed it now, just the very moment. We'll turn up here. This road was all dug up, so it was permanent. You couldn't get across here before.
And when did they repair it?
Oh, that just when the peace process started. That was part of it, to rebuild the roads and open it. This was all just done during that time.
And so this is County Fermanagh?
County Fermanagh.
So Fermanagh?
Yeah, this is County Fermanagh.
Just a few feet from County Monaghan
now. County Monaghan borders, yeah.
So tell me again, this plaque?
This plaque is in the member of Lewis Leonard, who lost his life. Tony Ahern from Cork. Dermot Crowley from Cork. Seamus McElwain, who we're after coming from. Jim Lina of Monaghan.
Do you know these fellows?
I know some of them. I knew Tony Ahern, Dermot Crowley. I knew Seamus McElwain, I knew Jim Reinhardt very well, Lord McCarney, Pete Ryan I knew,
and
McNally I knew.
Would they be some of the guys who came to the house in...
Some of them would have been, yeah. And Barry O'Donnell. Those are only some of the lads that lost their lives.
We're
on the Monaghan Road.
And in that gate in there, you think is
yes.
What?
That was the original McKenna homestead.
Oh, and what's there now? Do you know?
There's just a spin planted. There's no house there now.
Mm. I wonder why they would have left that spot.
Well, they died out.
Oh.
And there's one of the descendants living in England. That'd be the name of Frank.
Hmm.
The only descendant.
Right, so what do you remember about them?
Well, I remember talking about, we discussed, you know, the usual thing about the family connection and that. If I had been as wise as I am now, we'd have delved more into it, because they would have known more. And in fact, it's an awful pity I didn't write down everything my father told me. My father being the youngest of the family and Uncle Eddie being the oldest, sure, we should have asked far more questions and wrote everything down.
Mm-hmm. What do you remember of my grandmother and grandfather?
Well, I just remember very briefly meeting them in 4210 Dickney Avenue, Bronx, New York. I remember they came over there for tea. I had been on a visit to Rochester with my wife and my oldest son, Alan, who was only a year old at the time. And I remember having a very long chat. Uncle Oney was there and Uncle Packy came as well. That was the only time, in fact, that I
aunt. My aunt Annie. But that was in 1967.
Okay, this one's for Grandpa, this one's for Anna, Ellen, this one's for Keith, this one's for Aunt Anne, and this one's for...
Colette.
This one's for the McKennas.
And this is the church where my granny made her first communion and would come to church every Sunday. Monaghan Church, also St. Joseph's. Built in 1876, it was started, and completed in 1887. They ran out of money, I guess. So there's the confessional, and it's still, I'm told, very much the way it was when she would have been going to church here. Have you girls ever been in a confessional like that?
No.
When you go to confession, you go face to face with the priest? Is that what you do?
I've met some folks who say that I'm a dreamer, and I've no doubt there's truth in what they say. But sure, a body's bound to be a dreamer when all the things he loves are far away. Precious things are dreams unto an exile. They take him o'er the land across the sea. Especially when it happens he's an exile from the dear lovely Isle of Inishree. And light peeps across the rooftops of this great city, wondrous though it be, I scarcely feel its wonder or its laughter. I'm once again back home in Inishree. Valley. for ages and watch the rivers laughing as they flow, and then into a humble shack I wander, my dear old home, and tenderly behold the folks I love around the turf I gather, on bended knees their rosaries told. But dreams don't last, though dreams are not forgotten, and soon I'm back to stern reality. A thought